Hello, everyone. This segment is going to be the final segment for the Hollow and Round series. It's been going a while. It fell off the radar for me for a little while. And just recently, I picked up on it again and finished the two planes. So I'm ready to give my final thoughts on the matter and give them a test run. I just finished doing the two blades, so I haven't even let them touch any wood yet. So what you're going to see me do now is the first time that they're cutting. And you'll see how they came out, and we'll go over a few things and then wrap the series up. So let's take a look at what I have. So here is the round plane. This is what you saw me cut with the core box plane in that fancy jig that I devised. Came out real nice. So what I did was I took the router and I put a 5/8 radius on the back where it impacts your palm. And then everything else I took and I put a 3/16 radius around all the other edges. And then what I do is I stop them right up to here, and the same point on the other side, and then the same point on the back. And then the other thing I did was I took the same stamping convention as I did on my earlier hollows and rounds, and I stamped these two with the numeral 16, and that's 16/16, because this is a 1-inch round plane, so the convention is going to be in 16ths for all my stamps. So these were sanded to 150, and the blades were ground to 1200 with the slip stones. And the other thing which I mentioned in a couple of my videos is I always try and get the blade to stand up directly behind the wedge, and I was successful in doing that. So here is the hollow plane, same thing, the radius, the stamp, again sanded to 150, 3/16 radius on the top, same success right here with the blade standing up directly behind the wedge. There's a tiny little shift right here, but that's fine. I was able to get the wedge pockets pretty tight around the top. In the past, I've had some problems where the floats and everything, they kind of stray at the top. So you have all the contact and the fitting inside the pocket. But if they stray a little bit, this will look a little sloppy. So what you'll see here is these are okay. Same thing here. This one's got a little slop. You see right up in there, that's a little bit opened, but everything else is kind of nice and tight. So that's the kind of float work that you strive for when you're doing planes like this. And the other thing I wanted to mention, which is something that I struggle with, is you have to spend a bit of time getting these blades so that they'll cut a very, very shallow cut. These things tend to be hard to push. And I've experienced that for myself, both in the difficulty of being able to push the plane and also in the difficulty of being able to set the blade shallow. So you have to do both in combination. You have to make a sharp blade that's properly shaped, and then you have to be able to set it really shallow so it takes a super fine cut, and then you'll be able to operate the plane properly. Now, there's another thing that I want to mention about that matter. I have about 170 old planes. Most of them were made between 1830 and like 1890. And a lot of them are in mint condition. And one of the reasons why I think they're in mint condition is because no one could sharpen them. No one knew how to set them properly. And without being able to do that, the plane is unusable. And the reason they're in mint condition is because they were never used. They were just too difficult to use. So with these modern planes, you can see that 150 years ago or close to 200 years ago, they would have had that problem without modern grinding equipment, modern steel, modern power tools and light and such. It would have been real difficult to get the kind of blade configuration that I think these things really need. So that's something I wanted to pass along to everybody. So I got a piece of pine here in my little clamp device that I fastened to the bench. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'll try the round plane, and we'll see how this goes. So that looks pretty decent, and it's the full cut. So, like I said, though, you can never spend enough time sharpening and setting these blades. This isn't really a good illustration because pine is so soft. But for demonstration purposes and for my first time here, without spending a lot of time on the camera and editing and fussing, pine is a good test subject. So now let me go to a fresh edge right here. And we'll see about the hollow. Take a look at this. That's the full radius, the full cut for that, and then that's the same shape on the other side. Just a little bit, maybe a little bit better, but it's a curve. It's a little tilted off to the side. And so that's about it for the testing. And then of course the other thing that I wanted to show everybody, because I'm a little proud of this. If you recall, these, I did not use the hollow to make the round. Those were made and milled independently of each other. But when you stack them up and you register them against the same surface, like I'm doing now, you'll see that they nest together nicely. There's no shift in the way they're oriented within the body of the plane. So that means not only is both shapes compatible, but the shape, the precision, the geometry that's supposed to come off the jigs and everything else, where this shape is supposed to be in the body of the plane is correct for this plane, and it's correct for this plane, and when you put them together, they're correct to each other. So, and then if you also look at my video about keeping your stock flat, square, and without twist, what you'll also see is that all the work done to place the cutting faces properly in these planes is also a product of the flatness, the straightness, and the squareness of the blanks. And this was all done by hand. I have no jointer, no planer. I have an 8-inch table saw, but I hardly use that at all. So you see me do most of the work right here in my kitchen on this little plank and with hand tools. And many of the hand tools are tools that I made myself in other projects. So the greater lesson that I like to put forth to the YouTube audience and to other plane makers is that this is approachable from the standpoint of somebody that has a small shop or even something that you wouldn't even bother calling a shop, because I don't call this a shop. This is just where I work and it's my kitchen. But if you have a fancy area to work with, a yard, a shed, a barn, a garage, a shop, a basement, then you'll be in much better shape than me. And the information that you get from my videos should more than make up for the information that you need to produce these planes. I think they're great projects. I think they're interesting little items. They're throwback features that we tend to have gotten away with modern woodworking. Many of us just give in to the fetishes of collecting power tools and bits and shopping out of catalogs and stuff. This is not only a throwback experience as woodworking projects, but this is a throwback experience in terms of your lifestyle as a woodworker, because this is woodworking when it was done in the 1800s. So it's a lot of fun, and it gives you a greater appreciation of all the work that came before us, because there were a lot of cabinet makers and woodworkers that came along, and they didn't have it easy. So have fun with your projects, have fun with my videos, and remember, you stay strong. There's a lot of work to do, and we got to get it done. Thank you.